Welcome to the 17th episode, or rather the 17th part of the lecture series. Today we have Justice Kamal Pasha on the scheme of Evidence Act. Over to you, sir.
Good afternoon to all of you.
Good afternoon, sir.
Law, as such, all laws can be classified into two: substantive laws as well as adjective laws. But Indian Evidence Act is a peculiar kind of law which comes within the category of both. And when dealing with the scheme of the Indian Evidence Act, we would like to consider that it is divided into three parts: part one, part two, and part three, broadly. Part one contains chapters 1 and 2. Part one contains chapters 1 and 2. Part two contains chapters 3, 4, 5, and 6. That means chapters 3 to 6 are coming within part two. Chapters 7 and 11 are coming within part three. So part one, part two, and part three. Chapters 1 and 2 in part one, chapters 3 to 6 in part two, and chapters 7 to 11 in part three. Then part one, chapter one, deals with sections 1 to 4. Section one deals with title, extent, and jurisdiction. Section 2 was repealed by the Repealing Act of 1938. So that does not find a place in Section 2, is not there in the Indian Evidence Act now. Section 3 is the interpretation clause, which defines various things. Section 4 deals with the presumptions of fact and law. Therefore, part one, chapter one deals, section one deals with the title, extent, and jurisdiction. Section 3 deals with interpretation, and section 4 deals with the presumption of facts and law. Then, while dealing with the definition, right, that section 3. See, a peculiarity can be seen from the definition of court. Court includes all judges and magistrates and all persons except arbitrators legally authorized to take evidence. So, the section is very clear in saying that court are legally authorized persons to take evidence, and they include judges and magistrates and not arbitrators. Then, evidence, the definition of evidence. Evidence means and includes: one, all statements which the court permits or requires to be made before it by a witness in relation to matters of fact under inquiry. Two, all documents, including electronic records produced for the inspection of the court. Such documents are called a documentary evidence. So, in the definition of evidence, item number 1 and 2 deals with court. As I stated earlier, court does not include an arbitrator. Therefore, even if some evidence is adduced before the arbitrator, either oral or documentary, in the stricter sense, so within the meaning of the Indian Evidence Act, that is not evidence, because arbitrator is not a court. That has to be taken note of. That's why I have dealt with that provision now. Then, Section 4 presumptions, I'll deal with it later after the scheme. Then Chapter 2, which also comes within Part 1. Relevancy of facts. It deals with, chapter 2 deals with the relevancy of facts. It contains sections 5 to 55. Section 5 deals with the theory of relevancy. Section 5 deals with the theory of relevancy. Section 5 says, evidence may be given in any suit or proceeding of the existence or non-existence of every fact in issue, and of such other facts as are hereinafter declared to be relevant, and of no others. This section shall not enable any person to give evidence of a fact which he is entitled to prove by any provision of the law for the time being in force relating to the Code of Civil Procedure. So, Section 5 deals with the theory of relevancy. And the evidence can be given in judicial proceedings only in respect of facts in issue, and all facts which are expressly declared as relevant by this chapter. So that section, therefore, Section 5 deals with theory of relevancy. Then Sections 6 to 55 specifically provide for relevancy of certain facts. No evidence can be permitted which is neither an issue nor declared under Chapter 2. So evidence can be adduced only in respect of facts in issue, or and also facts which are expressly declared as relevant by Chapter 2. That is from sections 6 to 55. Okay. Then part 2 deals with contains chapters 3, 4, 5, and 6. Chapters 3 to 6. Part 2. Chapter 3. Facts which need not be proved. See, chapter 3 deals with sections 56 and 57 deals with facts which need not be proved. Facts which can be taken judicial notice of. Court can take judicial notice of certain facts, and they are contained in section 56 and 57. You can read it so that you can understand it. There is nothing to explain in those provisions. Sections 56 and 57. Then section 58 deals with the facts admitted. Facts admitted need not be proved. Section 58 says that facts admitted need not be proved. When a fact has been admitted, it need not be proved. Then pass on to chapter 4. Chapter 4 deals with sections 59 and 60. Section 59 and 60 deals with rules relating to oral evidence. 59 and 60. Section 59 says that all facts except contents of a document or electronic record may be proved by oral evidence. All facts except contents of a document or electronic record. Oh, so therefore, oral evidence means within the meaning of Section 59, oral evidence is in respect of proof of facts, sorry, 1 minute. Kasturi? Section 59 deals with oral evidence, and section 59 says that all facts except contents of a document or electronic record may be proved by oral evidence. So oral evidence can only be with regard to all other facts except contents of a document or contents of documents or electronic record. Then section 60 deals with the hearsay evidence. Section 60 clearly stipulates that oral evidence must always be direct. See, can you hear me?
Yeah, definitely, sir. Somebody has.
I see. Oh, there
yeah,
is.
I got it. Yeah.
Some distraction.
Okay, yes. Sir. Some distractions. Section 60 says that oral evidence must always be direct. Oral evidence must always be direct. So we will go to section 60. Section 60 says oral evidence must be direct. Oral evidence must in all cases, whatever be direct. That is to say, if it refers to a fact which could be seen, it must be the evidence of the seer, the person who witnessed the incident, witnesses it. If it refers to a fact which could be heard, it must be evidence of a witness who says he heard it. That is from the five senses that is contained in section 60. If it refers to a fact which could be perceived by any other sense or in any other manner, it must be the evidence of a witness who says he perceived it by that sense or in that manner. If it refers to an opinion or to the grounds on which that opinion is held, it must be the evidence of the person who holds that opinion on those grounds, that opinion evidence. Just like the postmortem, examination, etc., etc. Opinion evidence, forensic examiner, forensic report, etc., etc. So, oral evidence must be direct and it should not be hearsay then. Provided that the opinions of experts expressed in any treatise commonly are like that. Provided also that if oral evidence refers to the existence or condition of any material thing other than a document, the court may, if it thinks fit, require the production of such material thing for its inspection. The section 59 and 60 deals with the oral evidence. 59 says that all facts other than what is contained what are the contents of the documents or electronic records may be proved by oral evidence. Then section 60 says that oral evidence must be direct. It contains that hearsay evidence is not admissible as oral evidence. Then chapter 5 deals with section 61 to 90 capital A. Section 61 to 90 capital A. Section 61 to 66 deals with the mode of proof of the contents. Mode of proof of the contents of documents. Section 61 to 66 deals with the mode of proof of the contents of documents. At the same time, sections 67 to 78 deals with the mode of proof of execution of documents. So there is a subtle difference between the contents of section 61 to 66 and section 67 to 78. Sections 61 to 66 deals with the mode of proof, the manner in which it has to be proved, the mode of proof of the contents of documents. Whereas section 67 to 78 deals with the mode of proof of execution of documents. That's very important. Then section 79 to 90A deals with presumptions to be raised in judicial proceedings in respect of the contents of documents. So section 79 to 90A deals with presumptions to be raised in judicial proceedings in respect of contents of documents. So chapter 5 is an important chapter in the Indian evidence side. See, the first portion deals with section 61 to 66 deals with the mode of proof of contents. Then section 67 to 78 deals with mode of proof of execution of documents. While dealing with the proof of execution, see, we will have to deal with certain important provisions so that I can invite your attention to those provisions. Section 68 section 67, proof of signature and handwriting of person alleged to have signed or written document produced. If a document is alleged to be signed or to have been written wholly or in part by any person, the signature or the handwriting of so much of the document as is alleged to be in that person's handwriting must be proved to be in his handwriting. Okay, then we will deal with the section 68. That's very important because that contains the proof of wills. Wills are governed by section 63 of the Indian Succession Act, and its mode of proof is as contained in section 63 of the Indian Evidence Act, read with Indian Succession Act, read with the section 68 of the Indian Evidence Act. Proof of execution of document required by law to be attested. As we all know, a will.
Chinese song.
So now that we have both Justice Ram Kumar as well as Justice Abraham Mathews are here, while we wait for Kamal Pasha sir to come, so we are on a point wherein again, yes, after the clarifications given earlier, sir, regarding section 63 of the Indian Succession Act, then 68 of the Evidence Act, read with 90. Still, there is a lot of confusion regarding. We are not yet to come to a
final opinion.
Let alone final, sir. At least some way it could be channelized. How it could be constructively read. Abraham Mathews, sir. I think Abraham Mathews, sir, is also here. Yes. Because he had also, in fact, we had a consensus that 30 years and above, it could be Section 90 would apply.
Now, what is the confusion now?
Confusion, if we can put it in this manner, sir, that is, Section 90 is a general provision. It applies to all documents. When we have a special provision in 68 exclusively for wills, will not the principle of special governs the general applies? And irrespective of 30 years or otherwise, should you not fall back upon 68?
So are you saying that 68 will exclude 90?
Would prevail over 90. That is only a presumption. That is, section 90 is only a presumption that it could be, but proof thereof has to be by way of 68 alone.
But there are authorities indicating that 90 applies to wills also. Wills are also included in 90, is it not?
Prem, can you just step in? If you are the Prem.
No.
Yeah, we have been discussing this issue.
See, what I think is that one is 68, it's a special provision. 90 is a general provision which falls under presumption. Yes. Now, if you construe that particular Evidence Act, long back during 1800s, I had spoken with Mohanetan now. There was an English decision. I don't remember the name of the decision, which was referred in the judgment in Nanavati's case, 61 Supreme Court, K.M. Nanavati's case.
Yes.
That means the later provision has to prevail. If we go by that, first comes 68, and if in the will was excluded in section 90, normally the legislature would have done that.
Well, as in the case of wills, the later clause,
yes, construing or will, later provision
being ambulatory in character.
Correct.
So it can be safely concluded that even a 30-year-old will, if it is produced from the proper custody, it was duly executed and attested.
The due execution can be presumed.
That is what section 90 says.
Yes.
If at all will was excluded, then automatically in section 90, the legislature was so wise. We are presuming the because of those days. So James Stephen, he was one of the best jurists. That is why we could not even rewrite the Indian Evidence Act.
Yes.
We have fight it so hard because our legislature does find it so hard because the eminent jurists like Stephen James, who had the occasion to pen down, or maybe he was the senior most member of that point of time of the 13 member board which actually drafted the Indian Evidence Act. So he was an eminent jurist, and maybe that's why I think so, because we have to construe it in that way, because that's what is held by this Nanavati. It's a constitution based decision. I forgot that English decision. It is cited in Nanavati.
Yes, yes. Now, can you hear me?
Yeah, definitely, yes, sir. Definitely. Yes. Loud and clear.
Okay, okay, okay. Yes. Sorry. Right. So, section 68, we were dealing with the section 68. Form, as we all know, wills as well as leaves are documents which are to be attested by two witnesses. If a document is required by law to be attested, it shall not be used as evidence until one attesting witness at least has been called for the purpose of proving its execution, if there be an attesting witness alive, and subject to the process of the court and capable of giving evidence. Then proviso, that's very important. Provided that it shall not be necessary to call an attesting witness in proof of execution of any document, not being a will, which has been registered in accordance with the provisions of the Indian Registration Act, unless its execution by the person by whom it purports to have been executed is specifically denied. Suppose, in the case of a gift deed, if the donor, the person who has accepted, executed the gift deed, is not disputing the genuineness of the gift deed, in such case, can it be said that an attesting witness should be examined to prove that document, if in case that document was registered under the Indian Registration Act? No, it need not be. But if it is a will, then it is for the propounder to prove the will as contemplated under Section 68 of the Indian Evidence Act. 68 of the Indian Evidence Act.
63 of the Indian Succession Act.
63 of the Indian Succession Act.
You're right.
Yes, 63 read with the Section 68 of the Indian Evidence Act. As for Section 63, a will has to be attested by two attesting witnesses, and the qualification is that those persons attesting the witnesses should see the executant or executrix subscribing his or her signature in the document, and at the same time the executant or executrix should also see the attestors affixing their signature in the document, in the will. Then only it can be said that the will is a properly executed one. Therefore, in order to prove within the meaning of the proviso to Section 68, provided that it shall not be necessary to call an attesting witness in proof of the execution of any document, not being a will, so that proviso is not applicable in the case of a will. Will has to be proved as contemplated under Section 68. That was Section 63 of the Indian Succession Act. At the same time, in the case of a gift deed, even though it has to be attested by two attesting witnesses, it need not always in for proving that gift deed, one need not always examine one of the attesting witnesses, provided the will, the gift deed is a registered one within the meaning of the Indian Registration Act 1908, and especially when the executant is not disputing its genuineness. So there is a difference between the proof of will as well as other documents which are required by law to be attested. Proof of will as well as other documents which are required by law to be attested. That is it. Okay. Then the classic case is on the subject is Venkatachala Iyengar, a classic decision by the Constitution Bench of the Supreme Court. I am not remembering the citation, but when it's cast right, it is Venkatachala Iyengar's case. Okay. And then we were dealing with the Chapter 5. proof of mode of proof of execution of document. Suppose when an attesting witness is cannot be found, that is dealt with in section 69. If no such attesting witness can be found, or if the document purports to have been executed in the United Kingdom, it must be proved that the attestation of one attesting witness at least is in his handwriting, and that the signature of the person executing the document is in the handwriting of that person. So in such case, how to prove it? See, we can examine a person. If none of the attesting witnesses are alive, we can examine another person who is acquainted with the handwriting in the signature of that attestor. So that he can very well say that, I know, I am acquainted, I had occasion to see him affixing his signature, and I am acquainted with the signature. This is his signature. This is the way in which he is affixing signature. This is exactly his signature. If that evidence is there, through that evidence, such an evidence, the will can be proved even when an attesting witness cannot be found. Then, proof when, suppose the attesting witness comes and says that, he's caught by the other side, comes and says that, no, this is not my signature, I did never attend its execution, like that. He says that I do not recollect whether I have signed it, or I could not recollect whether I was there, present there, or I could not recollect whether the executant was present there. Even after admitting signature, sometimes he may say that like that. In such case, section 71 comes into play. Proof when attesting witness denies the execution. If the attesting witness denies or does not recollect the execution of the document, its execution may be proved by other evidence. So, through other evidence, its execution can be proved. It's not easy. Not easy at all. Not at all easy. How? One can see, if he denies his signature, and he is very confident, if the proponent is of the firm view that he is denying it with mala fide, and it's a false denial, then he can examine any other witness who is acquainted with the signature of the person. That means acquaintance in the sense that he must have seen the executant, the attestor affixing signature elsewhere, his signature elsewhere. And he can very well say that, no, yes, this is his signature. I am acquainted with his signature, and I had occasion to see him affixing signature. This is his signature. So those evidence can be, other extraneous evidence in such circumstance can be permitted to prove when the attesting witness denies the execution or says that I do not recollect whether I have signed it or not. In certain cases, even scribes of the document or persons prepared the documents, the will, can also be attesting witnesses, provided they are cited, they are in the document in the form of witnesses, attesting witnesses.
Animo attestandi.
Such an evidence is there. If he says that, if the document writer comes and says that, I was present there, I have signed the document, in the presence of the executant, and I saw the executant as well as the other attester affixing their signatures in the document. If such evidence is adduced, of course, the document can be proved. Okay, and then section 79 to 90A deals with presumptions to be raised in judicial proceedings in respect of certain documents. Section 79, we will deal with only that section alone now, because we won't get time. Presumption as to genuineness of certified copies. If it is a certified copy of a document, then there is that presumption is there. that presumption, the court shall presume. There, the court shall presume that it is genuine. It is the certified copy of the original. And it is, in fact, it is as good as the original. It can be made use of. Genuineness of certified copies. Then, section 79 to 90A, there's some presumptions relating to documents in judicial proceedings. Then, chapter, we will pass on to chapter 6 now. Chapter 6 deals with the sections 91 to section 100. Exclusion of oral evidence by documentary evidence. Sections 91 and 92 restrict the employment of extrinsic evidence in proof of terms contained in any contract, grant, or disposition of property, and any matter required by law to be reduced into the form of a document. If something is to be has to be reduced into the form of a document, then its contents cannot be proved through extraneous evidence, whereas it has the contents are the proof of that document. Extraneous evidence in proof of terms contained in any contract. See, oral evidence against a written contract, to vary a written contract, oral evidence, that is not admissible within the meaning of section 91 and 92. Then regarding a grant, oral evidence is not admissible. Regarding a disposition of the property, if it is through a document, the contents of the document have to be proved, and it cannot be proved through oral evidence. Then sections 93 to 100 deals with patent and latent ambiguities contained in a document. If there is an ambiguity in any class of a document, then it cannot be explained through oral evidence. The document as such has to be construed. Its form has to be construed. And then it has to be arrived, and a conclusion has to be arrived at. And it cannot be explained through oral evidence. Then, now we will pass on to part three. Part three deals with chapters 7 to 11. And chapters 7 to 11 deals with the production and the effect of evidence. The production of evidence and the effect of evidence. Chapter 7 deals with sections 101 to 114 capital A. That is with regard to rules relating to burden of proof. Sections 101 to 114A deals with rules relating to burden of proof. These sections determine on whom the burden of proof lies to lead the evidence. That I can point out section 106 now. I consider that is important, and the Supreme Court has also forgotten in a case to deal with the implication of section 106 in Govindachami's case. Burden of proving fact, especially within knowledge. When any fact is especially within the knowledge of any person, the burden of proving that fact is upon him. There in that particular case, Govindachami with the victim alone, they were alone in a railway coach, in a compartment. No other persons were there. She was brutally attacked, and in fact, according to the Supreme Court, it is not clear whether she jumped from the train by herself or whether she was pushed down by the assailant. See, that benefit was given to the to Govindachami in that judgment, but I feel that Supreme Court has not dealt with section 106, because when any fact is especially within the knowledge of any person, the burden of proving that fact is upon him. He alone is aware as to what happened. He alone was there. No other persons were there. He cannot take shelter by saying that there is no evidence to show whether she herself jumped from the train or whether I had pushed her down. He cannot take shelter, and he cannot get, in fact, the benefit of such a doubt. No doubt is there within the meaning of Section 106 of the Indian Evidence Act. When a particular fact is within the knowledge of a particular person alone, it is for him to prove. See, last seen together theory. We always used to deal with the last seen together theory when dealing with the circumstantial evidence in cases, especially in cases of murder cases. When a person was last seen along with the accused, and no other person were there, and the victim had not returned from the place he was to which he was taken by the accused. It is for the accused to explain as to what happened to the deceased, and whether the deceased had gone away from there, or there were intervention of other persons, etc., etc. Those are coming within the realm of Section 106 of the Indian Evidence Act. Okay. Then let us pass on to Section 107, burden of proving death of person not to have been alive within 30 years. My brother Abraham Matthew always used to take classes on Section 100 and Sections 107 as well as Section 108. And whether that was dealt with here or not, I do not know. But 107, when the question is whether a man was alive, it is subtle difference between these two sections. It's the contents are not one and the same. Whether a man is alive or dead, and if it is shown that he was alive within 30 years, the burden of proving that he is dead is on the person who affirms it, the person who says that he is dead. If he was seen within 30 years as alive, the burden is on the person who asserting that he is no more. Then likewise, Section 109, burden of proof as to relationship in the cases of partners. Section 108, burden of proving that person is alive has not been heard of for 7 years. 108, burden of proving that person is alive has not been heard of, provided that when the question is, this is also as rightly pointed out by Ramkumar sir yesterday or day before yesterday, I'm not remembering. 108 is also within the nature of a proviso. Proviso to Section 107. Provided that when the question is whether a man is alive or dead, see, the question is there, whether a man is alive or dead, and if it is proved that it is not, the wording is not shown, but and it is proved that he has not been heard of for 7 years by those who would naturally have heard of him if he had been alive. The burden of proving that he is alive is shifted to the person who affirms it. So the burden is burden to prove that he is alive is the person who affirms that he is alive. If he is not heard of for more than 7 years by any person, by the persons who would have naturally heard of had he been alive. So in such case, the burden is on the person, and if it is proved that he was alive, he has not been heard of for more than 7 years. There, the wording is proof and not shown, but in Section 107, the wording is if it is shown that he was alive within 30 years. But here, when the presumption is on of death, it has to be proved that he has not been heard of for more than 7 years. Yes, so then presumption. Note 1 to 149. See, we will pass on to Section 113, Capital A. When the question is whether the commission of suicide by a woman has been abetted by her husband. That is relating to abetment of suicide by a married woman, by her husband or any relative of her husband. And it is shown that she had committed suicide within a period of 7 years from the date of her marriage, and that her husband or such relative of her husband had subjected her to cruelty. The court may presume, having regard to all other circumstances of the case, that such suicide had been abetted by her husband or by such relative or husband. Abetment is a presumption regarding abetment. The court may presume. Either the court may presume that it existed, or the court may call for proof of it. But at the same time, section 113B is rigorous and very strict. When the question is section 113B, when the question is whether a person has committed the dowry death of a woman, that is, when the question is whether a person has committed dowry death, and it is shown that soon before her death, and if it is shown, not proved, shown, that soon before her death, such woman has been subjected by such person to cruelty or harassment for or in connection with any demand for dowry, the court shall presume that such person had caused the dowry death. Court shall presume its existence unless and until it is disproved. So there it is, shall presume. But some qualifications are there. When it is shown that soon before her death, she was subjected to cruelty or harassment for or in connection with any demand for dowry. That is the qualification there. And of course, explanation. For the purpose of this section, dowry death shall have the same meaning as in section 304B. Dowry death is defined in section 304B IPC. And for this purpose, section also, the definition of the term is the same. Section 114A. Presumption as to absence of consent in certain prosecution for rape. Prosecution for rape under this section 376, subsection 2, clause A, clause B, clause C, clause D, E, F, G, H, I, J, K, L, and M. In such cases, where sexual intercourse by the accused is proved, and the question is whether it was without the consent of the woman alleged to have been raped, and such woman states in her evidence before the court that she did not consent, the court shall presume that she did not consent. So it should be from any of the categories mentioned above, and also especially when the woman says before court, asserts before court in her evidence that she did never give consent for such sexual intercourse, then the court shall presume that she did not consent. There also the wording is shall presume, and the court shall presume the lack of consent until it is disproved by the accused. In this section, sexual intercourse shall mean any of the acts mentioned in clauses A to D of section 375. That is there. So these are presumptions in a nutshell. Then now chapter 8 deals with estoppel. Only three sections are there. Sections 115 to 117 estoppel, you can read it. Then chapter 9 deals with sections 118 to 134. 118 to 134. Sections 108, out of which sections 118 to 120 deal with competency of witness. So these provisions, sections 118, 19 and 20, deal with competency of witnesses. Whereas sections 121 to 134 deals with compellability to witnesses, whether they can be compelled, how a witness can be compelled. Sections 121 to 134 deals with compellability to witnesses. As we had pointed out yesterday, 132, a witness is if a person has to give evidence, he is bound by law to furnish to give evidence before a court in judicial proceedings. Likewise, he can be compelled to give evidence. So sections 118 to 118 to 120 deals with competency of witnesses, whereas the other provisions 121 to 134 deal with compellability to witnesses. Okay. Then chapter 10, sections 135 to 166 deal with examination of witnesses that we had almost dealt with yesterday, deals with the examination of witnesses. Then chapter 11, only one provision, section 107. No new trial, whether a new trial can be ordered. On an argument that there is improper admission of evidence or improper rejection of evidence. No new trial for improper admission or rejection of evidence can be ordered if the court is of the opinion that such evidence would not have varied the decision. Therefore, if the court is of the view that if the court is satisfied that but for such evidence, admission of such evidence or rejection of such evidence, the decision would have varied. The decision would have varied. If the decision would have varied, then a new trial can be ordered. Otherwise, there is no question of a new trial or for improper admission or improper rejection of evidence. Now, we deal with section 4 once again. May presume, shall presume, and conclusive proof. I am not dealing with in detail, as my brother Abraham Matthew had already dealt with those provisions. Presumption, these deals with presumptions. Section 4 deals with the presumptions. May presume is a presumption. Shall presume is a mode of presumption. And conclusive proof is also a presumption. Then, presumptions can be wholly classified into two. Presumption of fact, otherwise termed as natural presumptions. Presumptions of fact can be classified as, called as natural presumptions.
Or discretionary. Discretionary.
Exactly, sir. Exactly. Discretionary. Exactly. Excellent. Discretionary presumptions. Then the item number two, presumptions of law or artificial, that can be called as artificial presumptions.
Or obligatory.
Obligatory presumptions. Obligatory presumptions. Those can be called as the other is presumptions of fact, natural presumptions or discretionary presumptions. Presumptions of law can be termed as artificial presumptions or obligatory presumptions. Then, may presume in the Evidence Act, may presume comes within these sections. Section 86 to section 88 capital A, section 90 capital A, section 114, and section 114 and section 113 capital A. These are the provisions in the Indian Evidence Act which deals with may presume. Section 86 to 88 capital A, section 90 capital A, section 114, and section 113 capital A. Then, rebuttable presumptions of law. Presumption of fact, this rebuttable presumptions of law may presume, then shall presume. Then shall presume, see, section 79 to 85. Section 89 and section 105, section 111 capital A, section 114 capital A, and section 113 capital B that I have forgotten. Section 113 capital B. These are rebuttable presumptions of law. Then irrebuttable presumptions of law. What are the irrebuttable presumptions of law? That is conclusive proof. Sections 41, section 112, and section 113.
112 except when there is no access.
Yeah, access. Non-access. Non-access. When there is no access. 112, that is qualified. Section 41, section 12, and section 13. We will deal with the important provisions only. Then 114A. See, we will have to see, that is also may presume, section 114. 114, we will deal with 114 B, illustration B. 114 illustration B says that the court may presume that an accomplice is unworthy of credit unless he is corroborated in material particulars. Therefore, section 114B, illustration 114B, in order to attract the presumption under may presume, it is required to be proved, shown that it says that an accomplice is unworthy of credit unless he is corroborated in material particulars. Then I'll invite your attention to section 133 accomplice. An accomplice shall be a competent witness against an accused person, and a conviction is not illegal merely because it proceeds upon the uncorroborated testimony of an accomplice. So there is, in fact, it may appear that these provisions are in fact contradictory. Section 104, illustration 114B, illustration B to section 114 says that an accomplice is unworthy of credit unless court, he is corroborated in material particulars. At the same time, may presume. That is may presume. Court may presume. Court may presume. That is may presume. But here 133 is a substantive provision which shows that, says that an accomplice shall be a competent witness against an accused person, and a conviction is not illegal merely because it proceeds upon the uncorroborated testimony of an accomplice. So conviction is not illegal even if it is not corroborated in material particulars. That is the wording of section 133. See, when going by the provisions, we can say that the illustration B to 114B is only with regard to may presume, court may presume the existence of such a fact. Or the court may call proof of it. Unless and until it is disproved, or the court may call for proof of it. Here, it is only an illustration. Whereas, section 133 is a substantive provision in the Act, which says that an accomplice shall be a competent witness against the accused, and a conviction is not illegal merely because it proceeds upon the uncorroborated testimony of the accomplice, of an accomplice. So when dealing with these two provisions, these contradictions are to be considered, section 133 will normally prevail, but judicial exercise is not like that. Judicial exercise always say that what is contained in illustration B to section 114 is a rule of prudence. A rule of prudence. Why? It is stated as a rule of prudence. An accomplice is also a participant, criminalist. He has participated. He had participated in the crime along with his friends, and after that, he had participated in it. He was part and parcel of the crime, everything, the incident, and thereafter, he has betrayed his friends by accepting what was given by the, what was offered by the prosecution. So it may not be considered that always he may say the truth. He will be a puppet in the hands of the prosecution. Normally he will be a puppet in the hands of the prosecution. If he turns out and says that, no, I have not supported a scene like that, whatever the prosecution demands, he will have to oblige. If he does not oblige, he will have to bear the consequence. He will be in hot water. So that there will be a tendency on the part of the accomplice to take sides with the prosecution and to act as a stooge of the prosecution. He will be the man of the prosecution. He will act always under the guidance of the prosecution. So, and moreover, even he had participated in the crime. He had done the crime. He was also a participant criminalist. At the same time, thereafter, he has, especially when he has betrayed his friends also. He participated in the crime with his friends and he betrayed his friends. Whether such a person can be believed. That is why judicial wisdom always says that the illustration B to section 114 holds good as a rule of prudence, whereas the other one is only a rule of law, a rule of evidence. But the rule of prudence always is being accepted by our various high courts as well as our Supreme Court. So section 114, illustration B. In such case, we cannot say that there is a conflict. It is the other one provision is a rule of evidence, and the other provision is a rule of prudence, which the law courts should normally follow. Some other important provisions. Section 6, res justae. Section 6. We will have to consider section 6. Section 6, let's say, relevancy of facts forming part of the same transaction. Facts which, though not in issue, are so connected with a fact in issue as to form part of the same transaction are relevant, whether they occurred at the same time and place or at different times and places. Suppose a man is committing a murder, and a person could see the assailant inflicting the stab wound on the chest of the victim, and says in a panic, he runs away, and he's to a man, he spontaneously says that so and so stabbed him on the chest. That is admissible under section 6, relevant under section 6, because it is a spontaneous one and contemporaneously made. And moreover, the shouts made by the deceased, so and so, he stabbed me spontaneously without intervention of any third party. If a spontaneous version is given contemporaneously, those versions can be treated as res justae within the meaning of section 6. And those are relevant. That is section 6. It should be spontaneous and contemporaneous. Suppose to the witness who is seeing the accused stabbing the deceased, if a person asks, "What did you see there?" Then we cannot, and then he answers, "I saw him stabbing so and so." In such case, it is not spontaneous, because it is through an interaction. A question was delivered and put. It is a conversation and not a spontaneous overflow. If it is only a spontaneous overflow, then we can say that it is res justae. And otherwise, if it is made by way of an answer to a question, we cannot admit that statement as one under section 6. When such evidence is there before in murder cases or other cases, lawyers can make use of that opportunity to cross-examine by putting some questions. On seeing him, have you asked as to what happened? Normally, somebody may say, Endu patti, what happened? Suppose a person was sitting in a miserable state on getting a stab wound, and the accused was not present there, and the accused is took to heels after inflicting the stab wound. And one person coming over there and say, and sees the person, the victim, sitting in a miserable condition, almost dead. And if he asks what happened to you, so and so stabbed me. So that is, if he dies, it can be considered as a dying declaration. At the same time, it cannot be treated as rested stay within the meaning of section 6. So when examining, when cross-examining such witnesses, lawyers should always bear in mind that if it is through a conversation, it is not spontaneous and it's not relevant under section 6. That's one thing. Then section 8, last time we have dealt with section 8, so that motive preparation, etc., etc., everything connected with the, even though some evidence is not squarely admissible under section 27 on account of some on account of some defects, even then such evidence may be admissible in most times within the meaning of section 8, motive preparation and previous and subsequent conduct. So those are relevant aspects. Then section then as in alibi, etc. See, we cannot go through all the provisions in detail, and now we can have discussion. If see, I have given only you an outline and I have not gone through much into various aspects because time does not permit us to do it. If time allows, we could have done more. We could have dealt with more aspects in the Indian evidence side. Then relating to circumstantial evidence, I'll deal with circumstantial evidence also. Circumstantial evidence, in order to prove a crime through circumstantial evidence, when direct evidence is not available, we can deal with. Pardon? Hello?
No, that somebody is not muted. Yeah, I had done it. No, not
all right. Oh, okay. Circumstantial evidence. In the case of.
One second.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Circumstantial evidence. Various aspects have to be considered. There are certain established principles. Only the principles I will say. All circumstances relating to the incident, relating to the crime, shall be fully and cogently established. So, all such circumstances being relied on by the prosecution should be fully and cogently established. Then secondly, all such circumstances should form a complete chain, and there should not be any missing link. But some various decisions say that our Supreme Court says that even if there is a missing link relating to an aspect, and if the same is supplied by the accused in his statement under section 313 CRPC, or if the accused fails to explain all what was within his knowledge under section 106 of the Indian Evidence Act, in such case, it shall constitute the missing link, so that it can also be used as an additional link to complete the chain. So all circumstances should be fully and cogently established. All such circumstances that should form a complete chain, then all proved facts, circumstances should be incompatible with the innocence of the accused. That is, all such proved circumstances shall be incompatible with the innocence of the accused. Then there should not be any hypothesis than the guilt of the accused. Other than the guilt of the accused, there should not be any other hypothesis than the guilt of the accused. All proved circumstances should unerringly point out towards the guilt of the accused and none else. That also is there. Guilt of the accused to point out to the guilt of the accused and none else. So these are the principles to be followed while dealing with the circumstantial cases relating to circumstantial evidence. Then with regard to conspiracy like that and everything, see, we can deal with on some other occasion. Okay.
So thank you very much, sir. We got a couple of questions coming up. If you would permit me, I'll just read out one of the first questions. Of course, Shibu Vargis and see Ajit Kumar has posted questions. See, they will be asking it. The question right now before us is, sir, Section 16, 17 and 58. Admissions by the party council, there is 16 and 17. And
admissions, no, 20, 16 and
16, 17, sir.
Okay. On that's different. Yes. No, 16. Not 16, 17. But maybe they may be asking 18 and 19.
Could be, sorry, sir. 17 is admission defined. Admission of party proceeding.
Okay.
He would have meant this section 17, 18, 19.
All right.
Section 58.
Okay.
So the question is, in a 138 case, a notice was issued intimating the fact of dishonor and demanding the money. In the reply sent by the person who had issued the check, he would say that it's true that I owe you money and that I have issued the check, but I require some time for payment. So that's an admission in itself. And should we go through the entire proceedings of 138 of filing complaint, taking evidence, etc., is the first question.
That is an admission. That is an admission.
So can we on the filing itself insist the court to have a quietus of the issue by calling the other person?
Court cannot act on it because that section 58, we will deal with the section 58. No fact need to be proved in any proceeding which the parties thereto or their agents agree to admit at the hearing or which before the hearing they agree to admit by any writing under their hands or which by any rule of pleading in force at the time they are deemed to have admitted by their pleadings. Provided that the court may, in its discretion, require the facts admitted to be proved otherwise than by such admissions. Then we will go through, then section 17 is admission. Section 18, admission by party to proceeding or its agent. Statements made by a party to the proceeding or by an agent to any such party whom the court regards under the circumstance of the case as expressly or impliedly authorized by him to make them are admissions by suitor or representatives. Statements made by parties to suits suing or sued in a representative character are not admissions unless they were made while the party making them held that character. Then statements, then admissions by persons whose position must be proved against party to suit. The illustration to section 19. A undertakes to collect rents for B. B sues A for not collecting rent due from C to B. A denies that rent was due from C to B. A statement by C that he owed B rent is an admission and is a relevant fact as against A if A denies that C. Here, then admission by person, then proof of admissions against section 21. Proof of admissions against persons making them and by or on their behalf. Such an admission can be proved against the person who is making such admission. Then that what was the question thereafter?
The issue is that, sir, if I can understand from what you said, it is only dispensing with proof of a fact and not
only
the procedure
that,
to be followed. The
only
procedure
that
will have to be followed anyway.
Procedure will have to be followed and that has to be dispensed with. Okay.
So we got a question from Advocate C. Ajit Kumar. Ajit, can you? Yeah, Ajit, please.
Sir.
Yes.
Sir, my doubt is that invoking section 108, whether a declaration for a death of a person can be, okay. Whether we can approach a civil court, whether they can grant such a decree. If a person who has not been heard for more than 9 years.
Not possible.
Why not 9 years?
No, because section is 7 years. No, my case is that a person has not been heard by
9 years.
Okay. 9 years. My case is that a person has not been heard for 9 years. What is the remedy out to see that? There. Because now the widow is not getting any benefit with regard to the death certificate is not possible, sir. So they are not able to get the death certificate.
Not possible. No such declaration can be made. We cannot be declared that he is.
Sir, in such a case, what is the remedy out?
See, when the question is whether a man is alive or dead.
Yes, sir.
The question is whether a man is alive or dead, and it is proved that he has not been heard of for 7 years by those who would naturally have heard of him if he had been alive. The burden of proving that he is alive is shifted to the person who affirms it. She says that he is no more.
Yes.
The burden is shifted to the persons who say that he is alive.
Naturally, sir.
That only deals with section 108, only deals with the burden.
Sir, like Ajit asked, then every time you'll have to keep on proving this. There is no way you can have a final solution.
No declaration. It's not as status. What is contained in section 18 is with regard to mode of proof, and not with regard to any right. Brother Abraham Matthew can enlighten us on that.
Justice Abraham Matthew is here. Please, sir, can you just add on to that?
I have already
answered.
Mentioned this in my earlier class.
Correct. Sir, that I have not all the persons who are newcomers, sir, please.
108 is only a rule of evidence. It cannot form the foundation of a right.
Right.
In a properly instituted suit, if the question of death arises, this can be relied on. That is all what it means. Nothing else. What can you declare? You cannot declare that a person is dead. Why?
Status. No.
Death is not the status.
Status.
Death, only a person can be a status, can have a status. Here it is a dead body only. He died and he is not a person. So there is no question of declaration of status of that dead body. And I gave that one decision of the Madras High Court, that is a 2004 KLT 112.
Yeah, we'll circulate it, sir, right now.
Yes, sir.
112, and later another decision of Justice Hariprasad of the Kerala High Court. I can give that decision after a few minutes.
Yes, sir.
Okay, this is the point. See, there is no way out. Every time you have to prove, it's only a rule of evidence, a mode of proof, and not otherwise. It does not create a substantive right or status to be declared. Therefore,
I may add, is the remedy? That was the question.
Yes, sir.
Suppose you make one of your brothers or sisters as a defendant and file a suit for partition, alleging that he is presumed to be dead. Then this presumption will arise and you will get a decree for partition. That is the way out.
Brother, his doubt was death certificate. That is not
more. Yes,
not,
but not, sir, that, was
never, the more than the death certificate, the benefits that may accrue if he's no more. That is the benefits.
There is a fundamental misconception. That is that on relying on this rule of evidence in Indian Evidence Act, you can get any order from any authority. No. Indian Evidence Act rules are applicable only in a proceedings in a court.
Judicial proceedings.
Not before an executive authority. They are not bound by these rules of evidence. So on the basis of this rule of evidence in the Indian Evidence Act, you cannot get an order from a tahsildar or the executive magistrate.
True.
Exactly. That's it.
Yes,
that's
sir. It. Okay. But with regard to the benefits that the widow is entitled for, we cannot have any, sir, that we cannot
see,
have.
See, in a suit for partition, you can very well assert that he is no more, he is not head of more than 7 years, and therefore he is not alive, the property can be the partition can be effected through in a partition suit. There, suppose, provided other persons are made parties.
You are entitled to some benefits, and the person who is bound to give the benefit does not give you. You can file a suit against him. For example, an insurance company. You file a suit.
Yes.
That is a reported case.
Yes,
sir. Yes. The Supreme Court has dealt with such a case. Okay. That is AIR 2004 Supreme Court 2070.
Yes, sir.
Can you just repeat the citation,
sir? LIC of India versus Anuradha.
The citation.
LIC of India versus Anuradha.
Citation.
Citation AIR 2004 SC 2070.
2070. Right.
Okay.
I have a question. I have a question.
Unlike in the case of adverse possession, acquisition of title by adverse possession, where I think a suit itself can be filed for a declaration that he has prescribed title by adverse possession. Is it not? Mr. Abraham Mathew?
Right.
Now, Supreme Court has cleared it. There is no controversy at all.
Correct. Yes, Mr. Mantman.
Yeah, I have a question, sir.
Yes.
Sir, in the same decision, which is often relied on, the LIC of India case, there it often raises a confusion also. The reason is that
date of death.
Exactly. Sorry, I'm going through.
That is
because it is so stated by the apex court. There is no presumption as to the facts or circumstances under which the person may have died.
But then, I gave you another decision of the Kerala High Court, which took a presumption as to the date of death in an army man's death case. 2005 to KLT. 2005 to KLJ.
KLJ.
Yeah.
Okay.
Six double one.
Yes. Sir, my doubt is that.
That does not appear to be the correct law.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly.
Sir, yet another interesting ruling, I would say.
Yeah, Section 5, because Kamal Prasad sir has just referred to the term shown in 108. That shown has to be read or has to be interpreted within the provision of Section 5. Evidence may be given on existence or non-existence of every fact in issue and such other facts declared as relevant under the Act.
Okay.
There shown is the term shown has to be explained because suppose if somebody is having a pleading for the purpose of Section 107 and 108 that a person is not seen for 30 years.
Heard of
for 30 years. And 108 is that a person who ordinarily would have seen him for 7 years or more has not seen him. There in 108, the shown, that is the problem of a legal practitioner. When a question is whether a man is alive or dead, and it is shown that he was alive within 30 years, the burden of proving that he is dead is on the person who affirms it.
Okay.
There, the shown assumes importance. Whether it is just a pleading, or whether, no, it is not stated that it is proof. No proof. But in the pleading, it is stated that so-and-so is not heard for 7 years.
See, the answer is that shown means shown in the evidence. It does not mean that shown in the pleadings because this is a rule of evidence. Rule of evidence applied.
One second, sir.
Yes.
I am coming to that. That is, in the pleading, that's the nature of proof. I am on that question. Nature of proof is that it can only be by oral evidence.
Yes.
Yeah. There the difficulty that in AR 2004 Supreme Court 2070 comes in.
It need not be by oral evidence. There can be, suppose there is a photograph taken on a particular date.
Yes.
Correct. See the case of this North Korean leader.
Somebody who had seen him in Wuhan market.
Yes.
Eating bats maybe.
Even now it is possible whether he is alive or not. said that it was his dupe.
Correct, sir. Correct.
See, in fact, I had occasion to see a video which shows his funeral.
Somebody dancing, and he said he'll be sending sending notices to those persons who are danced. That will be the final dance.
Exactly, exactly.
So my question is that only facts need be placed before the court, nothing further, just the facts and the relevant facts. Is it sufficient for that?
See, how can you show a fact to the court? You can show a fact to the court only by giving evidence.
Evidence. Can be oral evidence.
Court will not look into the
abject field. No, abject proof is called for.
Because that is the decision I gave you. I mentioned one decision of Justice Hariprasad. That is 2017, Volume 3, KHC.
Okay, Volume 3, KHC.
1-2. That is 12.
Okay. Thanks.
So he has held, following this Madras decision, he has held that a two-part declaration of death of a person is not maintainable. Yes. And he has noticed the differences between this 107 and 108. That is, the word used in 107 is show, and the other one is proof.
Proof.
So he has said that it is a degree of proof that is different.
Exactly.
So we have a question from Shibu Vargas. Shibu, are you there? Advocate Shibu Vargas?
Yeah, I'm here.
Yeah, please, sir. Go ahead.
So the question was asked yesterday and it was discussed.
Remains unanswered.
I want to add a little more to that
question. Yeah, even today it is not audible properly.
If it is not audible, I think that question can be read. I have sent a message.
No, you can. Possible? Now you can hear
me. Yes. Okay.
Yes.
Yes,
we can hear.
The question is, while cross-examining, the presiding officer asked, what is the relevancy of your question? Okay, so in 138, we find that the cross-examination must be related to facts relevant facts. But when we come to 146, first one, that is, we can ask questions in cross-examination. That is, for convenience, let me read that section. When a witness is cross-examined, he may, in addition to the questions herein before referred to, be asked any questions which tend to test his veracity. Mostly, the cross-examination is for testing the veracity of the witness.
Can we get Agilraj? Agilraj, can you just mute? Agilraj, please.
Disturbance.
Yeah. So 146(1) permits the defense counsel to test the veracity of the witness. So when the presiding officer asks, what is the relevancy of the question? If the defense counsel tells, I am not introducing any evidence, I am only testing the veracity of the witness, how can that question be disallowed then? If he is testing the veracity only. So it need not be relevant as according to the sections hearing before. Am I clear in my question?
Okay. You go through section 138.
Yeah, I find that one.
The second paragraph. The examination and cross-examination must, the examination means chief examination, cross-examination must relate to relevant facts.
Yeah.
Comma. But the cross-examination need not be confined to the facts to which the witness testified on his examination in chief. So no court can restrict you by saying that no, you will have to cross-examine the witness only on facts testified by him in chief examination. Court cannot do it. Then 146. Questions lawful in cross-examination. When a witness is cross-examined, he may, in addition to the questions here and before referred to, be asked any question which tend to, one, to test his veracity. Questions can be asked for that purpose. Two, to discover who he is and what is his position in life. Three, to shake his credit by injuring his character, although it may tend to incriminate him. Okay, so these types of questions could be asked. It is not for the court to restrict such a manner of cross-examination by the counsel within the meaning of paragraph 2 of section 138 as well as 146 of the Indian Evidence Act. You can put those questions. The court cannot say that, no, these are extraneous matters. Of course, you can put extraneous matters to show that he has no veracity. So in order to discover his status, that means his position, then to shake his credit, etc., etc. You can put those questions. Nobody can listen to you in that, those things.
Okay, just like Pashupal.
I mad.
Right.
I mad. See, there is a fundamental difference between Section 5 and Section 146 and others. What does Section 5 say? Section 5 says that evidence may be given. Evidence may be given only with regard to the fact in issue or relevant
fact. Fact in issue.
Fact in issue or relevant facts. Nothing else. But there are some questions may be put. You are not adducing any evidence with regard to a fact. But you are permitted to put some questions for a limited purpose.
Okay.
So that has right. nothing to do with
evidence.
That has nothing to do with the relevancy or fact in issue. So okay. because one can ask. നമ്മള് കേട്ടിട്ടുണ്ട് സാധാരണഗതി ചോദിക്കുന്നത് നിങ്ങൾ എത്ര ദിവസം ഈ കോടതിയിൽ ഈ കേസിന് മൊഴി പറയാൻ മഞ്ഞിട്ടുണ്ട് വാസ് ഇറ്റ് അറ്റ് ദി എക്സ്പെൻസ് ഓഫ് ദി ഓപ്പോസിറ്റ് പാർട്ടി ദീസ് ക്വസ്റ്റ്യൻസ് ആർ പെർമിറ്റഡ് ബിക്കോസ് ദേ വാണ്ട് ടു നോ വെദർ ഹി ഹാസ് ഓഫേർഡ് എനി ബ്രൈബ് ബ്രൈബ് ഇൻ ദ സെൻസ് നോട്ട് മണി ബട്ട് വെദർ ഹി ഹാസ് ബീൻ ഇൻഫ്ലുവൻസ്ഡ് ബിക്കോസ് ഓഫ് സെക്ഷൻ 155 സോ 146 155 ഓൾ ദീസ് ആർ ക്വസ്റ്റ്യൻസ് വിച്ച് ആർ വിച്ച് മേ നോട്ട് ബി റെലവൻറ്റ് Whether they are relevant or not, irrelevant is not the question. Whether they are permitted. You are not adducing any evidence with regard to a fact, but you are permitted to put some questions for certain purposes. Those purposes are mentioned in Section 146. So the court right. cannot say that if it is not relevant, I will not permit the question.
Thank you. We have got Advocate Srilal Warrior here. May we have a question from you, sir? Just put a question.
good afternoon, Vajir. Okay.
Mischievous question.
The question is good. What was the object of incorporating Section 147? But please, sir, can you just come forth?
No, I only thought that there would have been a reason for each of the sections to be incorporated. Because lawmakers also have a good reason. They foresee something before they make a provision, I mean, when they get it incorporated, is there some specific reason why they have brought in the provision that have 108, 107, all this?
Right.
If there is something, then probably we could focus it on that. Some situation which they have contemplated. Just out of curiosity, sir.
Okay, very good. Right, sir. See, I have forgotten to deal with the section 112, birth during marriage, conclusive proof of legitimacy. See, we could have dealt with that aspect also. If no time, there is on some other occasions. The Supreme Court has in Nandalal's case has given a categorical decision, a classic decision by saying that DNA test, whether DNA test, in a case where there can be a conclusive proof, can DNA test disprove that conclusive proof? All right, settle. Okay.
Sir, regarding 112, we'll having a separate session on paternity right. and legitimacy, exclusively on that. One is a fact and the other is a presumption. So whether scientific proof can outweigh
settle by Nandalal. It is settled in Nandalal.
Yes. Gautam Kundu case where DNA can be compelled, etc. All those things will be exclusively dealt with in case.
Right.
Warrior sir, would you like to add something?
No, I just wanted to know. I am ignorant.
Do you have anything on that?
Yes.
Bandham, Jeremy Bandham has stated once that advocates of the worldly community who can have resort to ignorance of law.
Sir, we have Shaiju. He's shown his hand. Shaiju, please go ahead.
Yes. With respect to the incontinuation of 107 and 108.
Okay.
So we are usually getting decrees and we are executing partition deed, the families are executing deed also. Subsequently, okay. Mutations affecting and selling the property. That is a stage. At that stage, this person is coming back. Coming back. What will be the position? What will be the status?
Okay. That's why the courts cannot give a declaration. Courts should not give declaration because it's not a status. There is no right at all. And see, this is only a, say, a rule of evidence. Apart from that, see, the other things have to revive, whether in his absence, if his property has been dealt with, he is entitled to give restitution, he will get it back.
In continuation, suppose we are getting a decree for succession certificate issued by Munshi Court.
Succession certificate cannot be issued in that case.
Based on the remedy? What will be the remedy then?
And see, there is no such remedy at all. See, a succession certificate cannot be issued. A succession certificate can be issued only when there is a declaration of death. A person has to die. Only then a succession certificate can be issued. Otherwise, a succession certificate cannot be issued.
Suppose a person has deposited 25 lakh and he has went away after 10 years or 15 years, but how can this amount can be taken by the family member?
You can file a suit by impleading all the legal other legal aids. Only then you can have a decree.
Then 108 is operation.
It is a 108 is a mode in which we can say that see, he is not heard of for more than 7 years. And naturally, see, in the manner in which naturally the person's interested could have heard had he been alive. Therefore, he is to be presumed to be died. We can say presumed to be dead. If we can say like that, apart from that, we cannot do any other thing. So, you can file a suit, get a degree.
And I am asking, in bank scrutiny cases, there are several matters are coming with respect to the whether the loan can be a property can be mortgaged based on
it's not very easy. Bank should not do it.
Well, suppose
in the other case, if the man comes back, what will be the remedy? The bank will have to be the ultimate loser.
Yes.
So bank cannot do it.
See, 107 is presumption of continuance in life, which can be offset by
108. At least we have to wait for 100 years, let's say.
Sir, a continuation question has come up regarding that. That is a decision that has been rendered in one of such suits. For example, a deposit in bank and a suit has been filed and this provision was invoked and the finding was rendered that he is no more and it was given to the wife. Can that decision be used in subsequent proceedings or should again all the evidence to be adduced?
That decision cannot be used in the subsequent proceedings. Again, it has to be evidence has to be adduced afresh in other other claims.
Is it? Are you saying that it is a judgment in rem?
Even though the term is not used in the question, I think the intention is that once a decision is rendered, because it has all the all the circus has been done, and finally a decision has been rendered that such and such person is not more.
No.
If the subsequent suit is between the very same parties.
Another set of facts and another set of parties.
Legalists are the same. Can never be.
Cannot operate as a judgment in rem. Unlike the insolvency court or the testamentary court.
Even proof of a will, it is not a judgment unless there is a probate. Probate proceedings, okay. It's a judgment in rem.
Proceedings of the testamentary court.
The otherwise, it is the propounder to prove it. It is the propounder. Whoever be the propounder, he is bound to prove it.
Correct, sir. Premraj, yeah, of course, please. Yeah, you're going to unmute.
Okay. Now, Anish has asked a question. Could you just ask that whether it will amount to defamation? In a cross-examination, a counsel put certain questions. Would it amount to...
I did not mention that because we had in fact dealt with it yesterday. But still, now that the doubt has come up again, Anish K.R., can you just come forth. The question is, sir, it will be quite helpful for those who have missed few sessions of classes. If you could, thereafter, he has said that. One second, sir.
I cannot access my chat that
way. I can. One second. Anish is there, then. While examining witness in a civil suit, some defamatory statements and questions were asked by the advocate. Whether such can amount to defamation?
Why not? If it is not falling within the category of the protection of the fifth exception to section 499. See, fifth exception to 499 IPC. We will go through it. Fifth exception. That is the provision there. Exception. Fifth exception. Merits. Merits of the case. Merits of a case decided in court or conduct of witnesses and others concerned. It is not defamation to express in good faith any opinion, whatever respecting the merits of any case, civil or criminal, which has been decided by a court of justice, or respecting the conduct of any person as a party, witness or agent in any such case, or respecting the character of such persons as far as its character appears to that court. And also, exception 10, public good. See, if it is in good faith or for public good, then of course, it may not amount to defamation. But if not, if it's intended to insult and defame, the problem itself, the question itself says that defamatory questions were put. If defamatory questions were put, he'll have to bear the burden. Then it is defamation. Okay. Can we proceed against?
Then I will have a question. I will have a question which continues from that.
Okay.
If it not, because court is having the power under 151 to interdict. I mean, okay. Then comes 152 also. Insult or annoy.
Yeah, insult or annoy.
So 151 and 152, the court could have invoked.
Okay.
Now, if the court permits that particular counsel in a case of defamation, won't that particular presiding officer, won't he be abetting that particular defamation? Apart from the lawyer.
How can it be? Prime Raj.
Why not?
How can?
Judicial officers, Protection Act. Just Protection Act.
But can that
how can it be? See, the judicial officer, one thing, he may not be aware whether it is correct or not. It is correct or not. Whether he had ample evidence with him to show that it was not defamation, but it was, whereas it was truth. If it is truth, it is per se defamatory. It cannot be per se defamatory. Even when it is per se defamatory, truth is a best exception.
You can put in trial.
He may not know whether it is whether that was correct or not. We cannot say that the judge is a participant in the criminalism in that aspect.
Okay, that's question number one. Now, question number two. So, as we know, because even in the Indian arena, as we all know, even if we obtain certain documents or evidence, even by illegal means, it is admissible, and no court would be loath to accept that particular thing in evidence. Now.
Constitution, not lawful custody. Any evidence procured by illegal means. If it is otherwise relevant, it can be looked into by the court.
Okay.
Understanding the illegality in the procurement.
True. That's okay. Like what we call tape record evidence, which the party may not know right from starting, right from 62 onwards. That the usable Ismail Nagri case of 74. Sting operations, it may be evidence. Now, my question is...
Aram Malkani's case.
Then, the 9-judge bench in Puttuswamy, which held that the right of privacy that constitutes an essential limb of Article 21, in terms of that 9-judge decision, would these judgments be overlooked? Because right to privacy also is affected, because the party is not knowing, like the sting operation and the tape recorded evidence. Doesn't that need a relook?
Definitely. It may require a relook. Of course, I have not studied Puttuswamy.
Puttuswamy's case itself.
I have not studied. But I think it may require a relook. This tape recorder conversation
There is one more aspect to it. Like Wayne said, the circumstances under which you make a statement, when in sting operation, it may not be just like you are telling X, Y, or Z, whether it's confession, caught, admission, distinction, the same thing applies
unaware.
Here.
He's caught unaware.
Yeah, he's completely caught unaware.
That's the right to privacy.
Yes. Even a former judge of this court had a had been caught unaware in a sting operation.
Yeah, making one statement, it was...
Now, sir, another question, which is quite interesting. So, you were dealing with Section 1, which excludes the arbitrators and the
court definition of court.
Section 1. Let us just read Section 1 again. Mm. Which would say regarding the extension of the Evidence Act. Section 1.
Yeah, I can show it so that benefit of all.
One. Extend and commencement.
Extend, yes. Commencement, jurisdiction. Okay.
Exactly.
Right. Title, extend and commencement. Okay. It extends to the whole of India, except the state of Jammu and Kashmir, and applies to all judicial proceedings in or before any court. Including courts martial. Courts martial. Yes. Other than courts martial convened under like that.
Affidavit presented to any court or officer.
Not to proceedings before an arbitrator.
Okay.
There also it states.
You mean Army and Navy?
I mean because that Army Act of 1881, that was already repealed. Indian Navy Discipline Act ceased to be in existence. Because adaptation of law's order never brought forward that particular act.
Then except Jammu and Kashmir, that also is not there.
Exactly, everything goes out. Because except Jammu and Kashmir, other government edutthu kalanju. Section 19 prior to adinte edutthu kalanju. Act 34 of 19. But the other thing, still now with the Army Act as well as the Naval Discipline Act, it is still there. These two acts are there. Both acts have become obsolete and new acts have come. And it also, but not to affidavits. Now my question is, Evidence Act, it is procedural come substantive.
Army Act, do you want to say that there is no Army Act now?
No, it's not the Army Act now. Army Act is under, but not in the, not the Army
that
Act.
That is reenacted. There are two types of thing, one by reference and one by incorporation. This is by reference. Therefore, whatever happens to the original act, as and when it is reenacted, it will automatically apply. But if it is incorporation by incorporation, then if a particular provision of an act has been bodily lifted and incorporated in an act, then whatever happened to the original act, that has to be ignored. What has been bodily lifted will alone apply.
But the principle of incorporation by reference and incorporation.
Yes.
Okay, but the same thing under Section 306 of the CRPC, we have powers to give that to make the person an accomplice or to grant tender pardon. In which the PC Act, which is referred, is 1947. Maybe just like that, because in 1988 another fresh enactment comes. Right now we have another enactment of 2018. Now what about the Naval Discipline?
2018 Act? Is only amendment of the 88 Act.
The other thing was the entire Act, the 47 Act itself was repealed.
This principle will apply.
It has been held in the Ananda Narayan Bhatt's case by
any number of rulings, any number, right from 1979.
My question again comes, what about the Indian Navy Discipline Act? Because that is an act which we never adapted. India never adapted after post-constitution. Because adaptation of law's order is there. So it has ceased to exist. If it continues in statute, no provisions of the General Clause Act can apply. Neither Section 6, nothing can apply. As far as that particular Navy Discipline Act is concerned. Army Act, of course, it comes in a new shape and form subsequently.
Prem, if you just look into that act, they have just put an index and said that now refer to the Navy Act 1957, 64 of 1957.
That is because of this principle. That is the
seven.
The legislation by reference. Yes.
Doctrine of right.
Whereas it is not incorporation. Legislation by if it is a legislation by incorporation, then of course whatever happened, it has to be ignored. The old act alone will apply. But here it is legislation by reference. Whatever happened to the old act,
you just ignore. Just see the down portion of the screen, sir. 6, 7, etc. So as practice relates, etc. Then it is mentioned there.
എവിടെ ശ്യാമേട്ട കാൻ ഇറ്റ് ജസ്റ്റ് ഒന്ന് അണ്ടർലൈൻ ചെയ്യാൻ പറ്റുമോ
വൺ സെക്കൻഡ് ജസ്റ്റ് ഗിവ് മീ എ സെക്കൻഡ് സീ ഇൻ ദ ബോഡി ഇറ്റ് ഈസ് മെൻഷൻഡ് ആസ് ജസ്റ്റ് സീ ദ ബോഡി ഓക്കെ ഹിയർ യു ആർ റെഫറിംഗ് ടു ദ ഇന്ത്യൻ നേവി ഡിസിപ്ലിൻ ആക്ട് എക്സെട്ര ദെൻ 7 ഈസ് പുട്ട് ദേർ 6 ആൻഡ് 7 ഓക്കെ നൗ ലെറ്റ് അസ് ഗോ ഡൗൺ ആൻഡ് സീ 6 ആൻഡ് 7 യെസ് Inserted by Act 10 of 1927, Section 2 and First Schedule. Then S to practice relating to affidavit. Section C, the Code of Civil Procedure, etc., etc. Then the Code of Civil Procedure, such and such definition, judges. But in the book that I'm having right now, it is now referred to the Navy Act, etc. is written.
Okay, because in the book which I have, it is not the.
Maybe it's better to look at the 3 or 4 books because we don't know what kind of printing they do.
Okay, because I have a book of 19 edition of the Evidence Act, in which
the Indian Navy Act le court martial se Evidence Act applicable aanu ippo 57 Act aanu ippo applicable aanu Evidence Act applicable aanu
Alfie, that is a 57 Act alle
57 Act adhe adhe
19 പക്ഷെ ഇത് സി ഇത് വിച്ച് ഇസ് ദ പെർട്ടിക്കുലർ ആക്ട് വിച്ച് ഇസ് ഹിയർ 57 ആക്ട് അല്ല ഇത് നേവൽ ഡിസിപ്ലിൻ
അത് അതെ 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 ദ ഇൻഡിപെൻഡൻസിന് മുമ്പുള്ള ആക്ടുകളാണ്
അതെ ബിക്കം ഓബ്സൊലീറ്റ്
അതിൽ ആപ്ലിക്കബിൾ അല്ല പക്ഷെ ഇപ്പോ ആപ്ലിക്കബിൾ ആണ് 57 ആക്ടിൽ ആപ്ലിക്കബിൾ ആണ് കോർട്ട് മാർഷൽ ആപ്ലിക്കബിൾ ആണ്
Okay. Anyway, my next question is why it excludes affidavit also before the courts. Now, this is more or less like a substantive provision. Now, in the CPC also, a new provision has come in by the amendment saying under Order 18, Rule 4, proof affidavits. Now, doesn't that particular provision under the Code of Civil Procedure, doesn't it go against Section 1? Because this does not include affidavit. Evidence excludes affidavits of a living person. In the life. So, the term of CPC, they order 18.
Hello.
Yes, sir. Sir, Pari.
Yeah, yeah.
This does not take away the power of the courts. Section 1 does not take away the power of the courts to prove a fact by evidence. You see, Section Order 19, you see. Order 19, CPC. The court can ask the party or permit the party to prove a fact by evidence. That is why we used to give proof of affidavit in ex parte matters.
That is, see, if Order 19 is read, if we read Order 39, you can just see Order 39, the first sentence would be, were in a suit it is proved by affidavit or otherwise. There is no other order or a rule which starts with those particular words. Were in a suit, it is proved by affidavit. It is permissible to file an affidavit in an interim matter. Permissibility. Now I am asking, here you are reducing the chief's examination affidavit. Affidavit is being filed in view of the examination in chief. I mean as an evidence. So doesn't that go against this particular fundamental? That's my question.
See, Section 1 is only a rule of evidence. It is contained in a statute containing rules of evidence.
Question that has to be. See, I have not gone through this.
It's not a rule of evidence. Section 1, it cannot be treated as a rule of evidence.
It is in a statute governing rules of evidence. It does not take away the fundamental thing we have to bear in mind that the legislature is competent to make another provision in another statute in the same another statute, which is opposed to the provision in the Evidence Act. There is no law.
Well, sir, see, if it was not put in CPC, I would have definitely agreed. Now, CPC means it is a procedural law. Yes. Which runs against the substantive law like the Evidence Act.
If it is not a substantive law, it is a procedural law.
Evidence Act is not merely procedural. Not merely procedural. It contains many substantive things. Not merely procedural.
It is considered a procedural law. It is the main object is to control the proceedings in a court.
Maybe, sir, it is it is a procedural law, but it is not merely procedural. Several things are substantive in Evidence Act. Several things.
Don't say several things. Only a few. Don't say several.
It is not a mere procedural statute. Mere as CPC, it is purely procedural. Nothing substantive is there in CPC.
There is, Prem Raj, you would like to correct.
In CPC, sections deal with the substantive provisions, whereas orders deal with the procedural matters.
Let me explain myself. Substantive law within the procedural law. See, that is the thing. Okay. If you see the first sections, it merely says, this is the particular thing. Order and rule, this is how you apply. This is how you apply. That is the second body. It is, one is the body part and the other is the order and rule part. So this was my question. And finally, sir, regarding section 91 and 92, isn't it applicable only inter se? Suppose a third party comes. Can he say that I can, by oral evidence, I can go against this documentary evidence, whatever is there on record? In the case of a third party, can 91 and 92 of the Indian Evidence Act have any application?
In the case of a contract, on a disposition or like that. See, what is the role of a third party?
Section 92 itself makes it clear that it is applicable only between the parties. They are not bound by Section 92.
If I can put it so mildly, that is, Prem's doubt is that, okay, the parties are debarred, they are disabled. But is there any bar or prohibition in someone else entering?
There is. Even among the parties, if one of the parties has got a contention that it is void ab initio or
sham,
then
sham document, exception. Sham document.
Sham document.
Even sham purpose.
Correct.
Which is illegal.
See, when it is a sham document, your argument is that no such agreement is in the, is in force.
No transaction took place. No transaction took place.
Section wording in section 92 is clear. Have been proved according to the last section. No evidence of any oral agreement or statement shall be admitted. Section 92. As between the parties to any such instrument or their representatives in interest for the purpose of contradicting varying like that. Parties inter se. There is no bar as far as the other party, third parties are concerned.
But even among the parties, if one of the parties has got a contention that it is a sham document.
Correct. Specifically, if you are challenging the document itself, you need not. Then you will have to give evidence.
Yes.
Sham document or it was intended for some other purpose.
In sham document, unlike in the case of a binami transaction, in sham transaction, there is only one party.
Correct.
Binami transaction, three. Ostensible owner, real owner, and ostensible buyer, seller, buyer.
Okay.
And,
Your specific performance. Suppose you say that there is no agreement, this was only as a security. Then this section 92 is not applicable.
Not applicable.
You say that there is no such agreement at all.
Correct.
Exactly, that's correct. Because in such cases, 91 and 92 have no application. Exactly.
No application. AIR 1982, Supreme Court 20.
So can you just repeat the citation?
AIR 1982, Supreme Court 20. Reasons are stated there.
Okay, anyway, thank you, Kamal Pasha, sir. It was so good.
Okay.
I may add something.
Please.
In relation to section 6.
Okay, Russell.
Govind Chami's case was referred to.
That is 106. Not section 6, 106.
Section 106.
106. If I remember right, the prosecution itself examined two witnesses to prove ris justae. That means a man saw this girl jumping out of the coach. Two witnesses were examined by the prosecution, right?
No,
yes, no, sir. No,
yes.
Two witnesses were examined of two witnesses having heard another passenger saying that
yes.
Girl has jumped.
Yes, yes,
yes.
Not connected with the girl.
Two passengers from the adjacent bogey, adjacent coach,
right,
had
right.
heard another passenger making an utterance. That girl jumped.
So,
and that person could not be traced out.
Yes.
No. Sir. Sir.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yes.
Soumya murder case.
Sir, can we have an exclusive session of Soumya's both judgments, High Court and that's a very important. I'm asking because I completely heard the review and the original argument before the Supreme Court. So
we'll definitely. And
sir, that's a very important aspect because the public, even lawyers, are in doubt why Supreme Court has the point which now Abraham Edi sir has raised because Rastasta. Because
no, not racist. See, I was dealing with the section 106.
Yes.
And a matter which is exclusive within the exclusive knowledge of a particular person.
Here, the prosecution proved what happened. There is no question of 106. The prosecution proved the fact which is a
That was not there. One person saw a girl falling from the compartment. And he told another man. I was the man dealing with it.
I was the man dealing with it.
He was not examined.
He was not examined.
Was not found.
He couldn't be traced out.
That went fatal before the Supreme Court.
That is not necessary.
That is what we are saying, sir. It requires a relook or an exam, not for anything else, but for the academic interest.
Who was the person who had overheard him? Give evidence.
Right, exactly.
correct.
There is one article on that in the live law.
By honor of Justice Ramkumar.
Yes.
Sir, can I get the present view on the evidentiary value of dumb witnesses as well as the child witnesses?
See, we were dealing with yesterday. Earlier the term used for denoting these persons were deaf and dumb. Nowadays we won't use those terms. We use the term deaf, not dumb, because they are dumb because they could not hear. They cannot hear. That's why they are becoming dumb. So we used to style them as deaf persons of deaf. In for examining a deaf witness, interpreter must be used through sign language. Through sign language, such witness can be examined.
If he is competent under Section 108.
Competent. Competency has to be verified by the court, whether it is competent or not. Just in the case of a child witness. In the case of a child witness also, competency has to be ascertained by putting various questions to the witness, whether she can or he can give rational answers to the question. The word is rational answers to the question. If it is possible, if she or he can give rational answers, she or the child can be permitted to be examined as a witness. Just like that, in the use of interpreter also, through interpreter also, the court has to put those questions to the deaf witness. If the witness is competent, the court can permit through examination through sign language.
I may add, madam. See, an interpreter may be necessary or his service can be obtained only if the child has gone to school for training. Suppose she has not given any formal training by in any school or institution, then there is no question of employing an interpreter. Then the mother or any relative who is able to interpret these signs may be examined.
Okay.
That is the legal position.
Okay. Not the child. See, a deaf witness. Not a child witness. Okay, a deaf witness.
Okay.
Not a child. A deaf witness.
Deaf.
Oh, even if deaf. Even if it's a deaf witness, or that person should have a training in this specialized field, then alone an interpreter can be used.
Yes. No.
Because that is a scientific one. The child may not know it. She may have her own signs for certain purposes. Appol adu ariyavunna oralle kondu interpret cheyane pattullu.
Child, found to have testimonial competency.
Okay.
Then the question is conveying his answers. How to decode his answers. There has to be an interpreter. It can be near relative or a qualified interpreter depending on the educational attainment of the witness.
Yes.
Absolutely.
Sir, can I add, sir?
Yes, sure.
Can I ask? Sir, that is this competency of the witness that can be through the Order 32, Rule 15 inquiry, as just now stated.
180.
Order 32, that is CPC. Yeah, that is with regard to persons of unsound mind, that may be.
Alla, 180 alle, competency. Evidence Act.
Evidence Act.
No, CPC.
Order 32. Order 32.
Order
32 is only sued by or against minor. That has got nothing to do with this.
No, sir. The incompetency of the party, sir, like unsound mind, they'll be brought to the court and we'll be conducting this Order 32, Rule 15 inquiry. So to ascertain the incompetency.
For representing the minor.
That is entirely different.
That is for representing the minor. Who can represent the minor is the question there.
That is only for inquiry.
It has to be next friend if he is the plaintiff. It has to be a guardian.
Guardian in the defendant.
Defendant. And this is 118.
118 competency.
Last part of 118.
Madam saying that the inquiry has to be.
One second. We can show it on screen also, sir, but we'll. Who can testify? 118.
Yes.
All persons shall be competent to testify unless the court considers that they are prevented from understanding the question put to them. All persons shall be competent to testify unless the court considers that they are prevented from understanding the question put to them or from giving rational answers to those questions by tender years, extreme old age, diseases, either of body or mind, or any other cause of the same kind. Explanation is there. Is not incompetent to testify unless he is prevented by his lunacy from understanding the questions put to him and giving rational answers to them.
It is understanding. The quality of understanding, the capacity to understand is the crucial test.
Yes.
Okay, thank you, sir. Thank you, sir.
And one more person had raised their hand. One second.
Res gestae can happen in not only under Section 6. Res gestae is relevant even under Section 7, 8, 9, 14.
All right.
Sir, again, Govindaswamy. The 106 was overturned by Justice Lalit that time. I'm still remembering. Says that if prosecution got a case that, if because of this prosecution got a case that there is a rest stop because somebody has informed me. If it is not there, 106 would have been applied. If it since it is there, it is because there is a lacuna on the part of prosecution in not raising that person. That is why
we will have a threadbare discussion on
I think we might have to have a sting operation to get the answers from Kamal Pasha.
No, it's over. Everything is over.
Okay.
So there is one
regarding competency of witness, deaf witness, section 119, witness unable to communicate verbally. A witness who is unable to speak may give his evidence in any other manner in which he can make it intelligible, as by writing or by signs. But such writing must be written and the signs must be made in open court. Evidence so given shall be deemed to be oral evidence, provided that if the witness is unable to communicate verbally, the court shall take the assistance of an interpreter or a special educator in recording the statement, and such statement shall be videographed. See, this is the provision under section 119. Okay. In continuation of section
190. This is what exactly Abraham Matthew sir said. The interpreter can be a professional person or a person who, if the child or the major person does not have a education, it can be by any person who understands it and conveys to the court.
Exactly. The wording is clear. Communicate with the court shall assistance of an interpreter or a special educator.
Correct.
Special educator. Okay, all right.
Correct. Any other questions from any quarters?
We can ask sir also, because regarding that section, interplay of section 68 and 90.
Should be confined to a solitary section, because we have been dealing with that for quite some time.
Section 63 Indian Evidence Indian Succession Act and section 68 of the Indian Evidence Act.
Section 63, 68 and 90 is the issue, sir.
Right. Elaborate discussion is required.
So I think that can be confined to something. We will have a session exclusively on wills that we were discussing last time also. And I'm sure that Mohan Kumar sir has already started working on that to initiate the deliberations. We'll go on that with wills alone. Now, do we have any other questions? Shaiju, your hands are still up. I mean, do you have any further question or you forgot to put your hand down?
Ajit also was asking. Shall
I ask a question?
Yeah, Mr. Balan. Yes, sure. Yes. Advocate Balan, please.
Sir, burden of proof of a will. The Shyam sir is telling that there is a special session for will. But I have doubt. The burden of proof of a will under section 90 of the Indian Evidence Act, sir.
Burden of proof is on the proponent of the will. It is for the person who propounds the will to prove it. That is that is dealt with in the landmark decisions.
Venkata Jalai Yanga. 59 Supreme Court.
59 Supreme Court.
We have already put that decision. Manoharlal has already put that decision in the group.
Okay. Venkata Jalai Yanga says that it is for the propounder to prove it. The propounder has to prove. It is his bounded duty to dispel all the suspicious circumstances.
Unless the will is attacked on the ground of the vitiating circumstances like coercion, fraud, etc. Which case the burden shifts to that person who alleges.
Okay. Right. Exactly.
Hello.
Yes.
Hello.
Yes.
We
can hear you, Abraham Matthew.
Yes.
May I leave now?
Sir, thank you, sir, and we'll definitely tomorrow we are having Sri Lal Warrior, sir. He'll be dealing with exclusively on the delicacies and intricacies of civil trial and civil practice. We'll definitely meet up with you, sir, tomorrow. Sri Lal Warrior, sir, is also here, very much available with us today.
Okay.
ശ്യാം സാർ ഒരു സംശയം ചോദിച്ചോട്ടെ. രാംകുമാർ സാർ എബ്രാഹിമൻ സാർ പള്ളി പോയി, ഇനി രാംകുമാർ സാർ മാത്രം ബാക്കിയുള്ള നമ്മുടെ
ഇല്ല പോയിട്ടില്ല, പോകുന്നേ ഇപ്പൊ വേണേ പിടിച്ചാൽ
കിട്ടും. കമാൽ പാഷ ഹിയർ ഈസി ഡോമിനസ് ലിറ്റിസ്
സംശയതാണ്. നേരത്തെ മാഡം ചോദിച്ചു ഓർഡർ 32 റൂൾ 15 പ്രൊസീഡിയേഴ്സിനെ കുറിച്ച് ചോദിച്ചു.
അത് റെപ്രസെന്റേഷൻ അല്ലേ, ഹൗ ടു റെപ്രസെന്റ് ദി മൈനർ.
അതില് അല്ല സർ, അത് 118 ആയിട്ട് ബന്ധമുണ്ടെന്നാണ്. 118 ടെസ്റ്റിഫൈ ആണ്
കോമ്പിറ്റൻസി. കോമ്പിറ്റൻസി പറ്റത്തില്ല, ബിക്കോസ്
കോമ്പിറ്റൻസി ടു ടെസ്റ്റിഫൈ അല്ലേ,
ടെസ്റ്റിഫൈ ആസ് എ വിറ്റ്നസ്. ടെസ്റ്റിഫൈ ആസ് എ വിറ്റ്നസ് ആണ് ഇവിടെ ടെസ്റ്റിഫൈ ആണ്.
ഇൻകോമ്പിറ്റൻസി കൊണ്ടാണെന്നാണ് എന്റെ
സംശയം. So nothing to do with the competency.
Sir, we have one more hand going up. Kiran Varma. Kiran, please.
Yes, sir, my question is, how far a statement of a co-accused? You are in police custody.
You are still, still on the topic of day before yesterday.
Kiran, should say.
We discussed section 30 of the Evidence Act, which only says court may take into account. It does not say court may, court shall consider, or court shall take, court shall take it as proof. It doesn't say that. Therefore, courts, our Supreme Court has taken the view that unless it is substantially corroborated, confession of a co-accused. He himself is a partner in crime. Participis criminis. Therefore, courts have taken the view that unless it is substantially corroborated on all material particulars, confession of a co-accused, that too he should be tried along with the other accused also. There should be joint trial. If there is a joint trial, then only Section 30 has application even. And even when they are jointly tried, it can be taken into consideration only if the statement is substantially corroborated on material particulars. Otherwise, court will not rely on that. I gave you the citation also.
Correct, sir. Day for yesterday.
Yes. 64 Supreme Court is there. Year 1964 Supreme Court. Then I gave you a constitutional bench decision also.
So we have got Shajit. Shajit. Yeah, Shajit. You have a question. Prem was saying that you got a question. Unmute.
Here is evidence.
Yeah, here is evidence. Shajit, please.
Yeah, day before yesterday. Hello, can you hear me? Day before yesterday, in fact, the question ought to have been put to Honorable Justice Ram Kumar. Honorable Justice Ram Kumar mentioned about the case wherein an accused was given in custody after the period of time, which was wrongly given by the magistrate. But okay, after that, recovery was affected. Whether that recovery will be tainted or not, and Justice Ram Kumar held that that recovery is illegal. So I have got a doubt.
Recovery is legal, na parang
eh? No.
When
was,
when questioning is done after the first 15 days, is it not?
Yes.
He is in judicial custody.
Yes, sir.
He is not in police custody.
Then, but custody was, subsequently custody was given after 15 days and after that recovery was effected.
Yes.
My doubt is whether it will affect the recovery even if that police custody is illegal.
It should, is it not? It should. The other principle will not apply, that a illegally procured evidence can be looked into by the court. It is not like that. In patent violation of the law, custody has been ordered. Or rather, here, this is one subterfuge adopted by investigating agencies like the CBI. In fact, in the case which the recent judgment of Justice Dias, when the police officer is an accused, he was released on bail. He was in custody for 43 days, murder case. Then he was granted bail by the High Court. Then this grant of bail was challenged before the Supreme Court, and his bail order was set aside by the Supreme Court. Not cancelled, but set aside for the reason that bail was granted too early. He should not have been granted that early. And bail order was set aside. And he was again remanded to custody. Then, the prosecution did not file the police report, the final report within 90 days. Question was whether the fresh registration of a crime by CBI would give a new lease of life to the CBI, say to contend that this is a fresh investigation which has nothing to do with the earlier investigation. That is the question. Very rightly answered by Justice Dias by holding that just because if a second FIR is registered, it's only the same first FIR, and the first date of arrest has to be reckoned for the purpose of deciding this default bail, and arrest and remand has to be taken into account. And the two periods of custody could be tacked on for the purpose of Section 167 to provide so, is the finding now.
One more doubt.
Shahjit,
yes.
I have another view with regard to regarding that aspect. Yes. See, this is a case where a person was given to police custody. Of course, the magistrate overlooking the provisions of law, maybe. Whatever yes. it be, he was in the custody of the police.
Exactly.
He came into the hands of the police. It has time and again, it has been decided that for dealing with the custody within the meaning of Section 26 and as well as the 27, arrest is not a prerequisite.
Not necessary.
So if a person comes to the hands of the police, a police officer, why can't we say that he is in custody?
He is in custody.
See, whether custody is legal or not.
No, I had given a different illustration. Oh. I had given an illustration where he was remanded after giving police custody. He was remanded and he was in judicial custody. Then the investigating agency takes the permission of the court to question him.
His question is that he was given to the again given back to the police.
My illustration given was while in judicial custody, permission was granted by the magistrate for questioning him, and the new agency, armed with the permission, went to the sub jail, questioned him. Well, that is judicial custody.
That illustration, if that is the illustration, of course.
It is judicial custody. 27 contemplates police custody.
Right. If he is given to custody of the police by the magistrate again, whether knowingly or unknowingly, then it will constitute police custody. But if not, if he continues to be in judicial custody and he is permitted to be examined by the investigating officer at the jail, of course, he continues to be in judicial custody, not in police custody. That is right.
Then again, the question is whether it will come within the purview of Section 8, even if 27 will go. If 27 will be attracted, it will be attracted under Section. It will be admissible under Section 8.
Yes. But then if he had already stated before the court or the officer that I have nothing to confess, and if the recovery evidence comes thereafter, the other rulings which I mentioned to you, Judicial Bench rulings. Justice Rapiti Ravanayar, etc., and Justice Kali, etc., then that will have court can very well assume that third degree methods had been applied on him, employed to effect a recovery. Artificial
excuse.
Court may reject those evidence. If you want, I can give you the citation. Had given you the citation, I suppose.
I think it has been given. We have in the notes, I think.
Already given, not as well. Thank you.
Okay, Shahjit, now we have got Vanamala, Advocate Vanamala, are you there? You got a question posted. Can you just ask the question? Advocate Vanamala. Okay, Advocate Neeraj Rahman. Neeraj, please. Hello.
Shyam.
Yeah.
Shyam, it is fasting. I am on fasting.
Yeah, I understand, sir. Absolutely. Oh, I'm sorry, sir. So, never mind. One thing, sir.
Time for him to break the fast.
not break, but break the fasting. But namaskar. I would like to pray.
Yeah, that of course, sir. Sir, definitely. For that matter, we'd say thank you very much for being yesterday and today. And with Ramkumar sir and it was a wonderful experience for us because we had the privilege of sharing the thoughts and the wisdom of all the three of you. And tomorrow we have Sriman Warrior, sir. I wish, I hope and wish and request that all of you be there also, so that it will be much more better interaction. And
thank you
very much, sir.
I have some personal inconvenience tomorrow. On other days, I can. No problem.
Day after tomorrow, it is law of receivers by Justice V. Chidambaresh. Day after tomorrow.
Yes. I remember a client of ours from Malappuram coming to us while I was practicing. Vakile oru deceiver na vekkanallo.
He erred into the correct expression.
Yes.
Okay. Thank you very much. Thank you everybody for the participation.
Thank you.
And all the doubts can be resolved. We can resolve it during the course of our continuing session.
And keep let them put it in writing so that we can give written reply.
Okay. Written reply. Okay. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you.